After Muhammad Ghori, India was ruled by Turkish Sultan under the Ilbari Turkish clan, and these Ilbari Turkish clan remained for 320 years under five dynasties. What were those five dynasties? Those were the Slave Dynasty, Khilji Dynasty, Tughlaq Dynasty, Sayyid Dynasty and Lodi Dynasty. The time period from which it was 1206 to 1526. And in this lecture, we would understand how these dynasties progressed, who were the major rulers in each of these dynasties, and what was the major development in the field of art and architecture. So I repeat again, the five dynasties are the Slave, Khilji, Tughlaq, Sayyid and Lodi dynasty. Among the Delhi Sultanate, the first dynasty was the Slave Dynasty. Now, Slave Dynasty, which remained in power from 1206 to 1290, was an interesting time and an interesting dynasty to understand. During this time, we had seen that so far Muhammad Ghori invaded India, and interesting to note that the slave of Muhammad Ghori rose to power, and he was Qutbuddin Aibak, with whom the Slave Dynasty started. Later on, interestingly, slave of Qutbuddin Aibak rose to power, and he was Iltutmish. Iltutmish was followed by his daughter Razia Sultan. Later on, you had Nasiruddin, his youngest son, who rose to power, followed by the father-in-law of Nasiruddin, who was Balban. So that's how we would understand the Slave Dynasty. To begin with, Slave Dynasty, the word originates from an Arabic word which is Mamluk. The word Mamluk in Arabic means owned. Now, Qutbuddin Aibak, who was the founder of the Slave Dynasty, was one of the generals under Muhammad Ghori, but because of his merit, he rose to power and he was appointed the governor of Indian conquest. Later on, when he was appointed the governor, he started with the foundations of Slave Dynasty and followed a policy of consolidation through matrimonial alliances. So what interestingly he did was Tazuddin Yildiz, who was the governor of Ghazni during that time, he married the daughter of Tazuddin Yildiz and therefore consolidated his empire. He was a strong believer of art and architecture. As a result, Qutub Minar was built during his time. Also, Quwatul Islam Mosque was built during his time. So, two important developments that we can see under Qutbuddin Aibak are the Qutub Minar and Quwatul Islam Mosque. The next is he was also known as Lakh Baksh. Why Lakh Baksh? Because it is believed that he donated generously to both Hindus and Muslims, and therefore he was called as Lakh Baksh or the giver of lakhs. Also, interesting to note was his last time he was playing polo, and he had an untimely death while playing Indian polo, which is also known as Chogan. Following his death, his son Aram Shah rose to power, but he was overthrown immediately by his own slave, the slave of Qutbuddin Aibak, and he was Iltutmish. So Iltutmish had no hereditary. He rose to power on his own merit and became one of the most efficient rulers of Slave Dynasty. Also, therefore, he is known as the real founder of Slave Dynasty. Very, very important to note. And slowly and gradually, as you can see here, he conquered most of the North India. Now, as he moved, he conquered the regions of Mandu, Ujjain, Gwalior, Malwa. So, those were some of the areas that he conquered. He also shifted the capital from Lahore to Delhi, and the capital was shifted to Delhi from Lahore under the rule of Iltutmish. He saved Delhi from the attacks of the Mongols during that time. Also, he got the claim to the throne, which was finally approved by the caliphs. So those were some of the major developments that we have seen under Iltutmish. The work of Qutub Minar, which was started by Qutubuddin Aibak, was completed finally by Iltutmish. So the work started by Qutubuddin Aibak and was completed by Iltutmish, and under his rule, whole of the empire was divided into iktas. These iktas were also basically called as provinces in the common language. So these iktas were maintained by whom? Definitely, so ikta was maintained by iktadars. So iktadars were responsible for maintaining the law and order situation in the region. So those were some of the major developments. Now soon after him, there was a group of 40 Turks who were known as Chahalgani. Chahalgani were of the view that the son of Iltutmish should rise to power. However, none of the son of Iltutmish was able, and one of the sons of Iltutmish, who was Rukiuddin Firoz, was brought to throne, but he was unworthy, and he later on, the Chahalgani agreed to choose Razia Sultan as the real ruler. So Razia remained in power for 4 years. She was the daughter of Iltutmish, but was a brave, intelligent, benevolent, wise and a just ruler. She even rode horses and used to sit in open darbars. Initially, the nobles accused her of being very friendly to Yakut Khan, who was an Abyssinian ruler, and later on, it was believed that she married and won over the province of Altunia. Now, once she had the province of Altunia, both of them, Razia and her husband, were trying to break the rebellions, but they were killed in the war against, which was by the rebels in 1240, and the death of Razia Sultan created extreme chaotic conditions in the slave dynasty. Mongols started to attack from the north. Lahore was captured and there was lots of death and destruction. Also, one important thing to note during this time was Razia, though was a very able ruler, most of the nobles did not want it to be ruled under a woman, and therefore there was a constant acquisition of being friendly to Yakut Khan from Abyssinia. The next was Nasiruddin Muhammad. So after Razia Sultan, as we saw, Mongols captured and attacked the areas of Lahore. There was huge destruction during this time. And after a period of 4 to 5 years of turmoil, the youngest son of Iltutmish rose to power at a very young age of only 17 years. However, since he was very young at that age, he could not manage the affairs well and therefore was succeeded by his father-in-law. His father-in-law was Ghiyasuddin Balban, and Ghiyasuddin Balban is known for the developments that he did during his period of 20 years that he was in power. He totally weakened the power of the nobles and had a clear distinction between the sultans and the nobles. It is believed that he performed two rituals, Sijda and Peboz. Sijda means lying down and wishing the king by putting yourself down on the ground, and Peboz means kissing the feet of the king. So both of these acts were to be performed by the nobles, and he was only person to actually realize the real problem within the Turkish schemes that were there. So he followed a policy of blood and iron. He reformed the army. He made people involved. The nobles, the courtmen were very, very loyal to Ghiyasuddin Balban. He also was able to check the invasion of Mongols from the north. He had a very efficient spy system and believed in the theory of kinship. His concept of kinship said that king is the representative of God on earth, and therefore he was well worshipped or well praised by the nobles. Now, also he was responsible for crushing the Chahalgani, the 40 nobles who actually rose Razia to power. So he crushed the power of the Chahalgani, the 40 Turkish nobles. So those were some of the important developments. Along with that, he also built in a chain of forts, and this chain of fort was an idea to protect the invasions of Mongol from the north. However, he died of an illness in 1286, and therefore his successors, who were very very weak, could not remained to power, and the Mamluk dynasty, after a period of 3 to 4 years after his death, ultimately lost the power. And after the slave dynasty or the Mamluk dynasty, the next dynasty that rose to power was the Khilji dynasty. Khilji, who were the second in order of the Delhi Sultanate after the slave dynasty, had the founder Jalaluddin Khilji. Now, Jalaluddin Khilji was in power for 6 years. His only major development was the raid over Devagiri, or which was also the Daulatabad, the present region in Maharashtra. And this raid was not conducted by Jalaluddin, the founder of Khilji dynasty, himself, but his nephew and also his son-in-law, and he was Alauddin Khilji, one of the most popular and well-known leaders of the Khilji dynasty. So later, when Jalaluddin wanted to actually congratulate Alauddin Khilji, his son-in-law and nephew, at that point Alauddin Khilji killed Jalaluddin and rose to power. The nephew and the son-in-law of Jalaluddin Khilji, Alauddin Khilji, rose to power. As we know, he raided the fort of Daulatabad, returned back to Jalaluddin with lots of wealth, and finally was the one responsible to kill Jalaluddin, and Alauddin Khilji then rose to power. During the time of Alauddin Khilji, we have seen numerous systems that developed. Dag and Chera are some of the most renowned systems that were popular even till the time of Mughal Empire, and that we have studied again in Mughal Empire how these systems were revived. So Chera, which was the grant for the soldiers, and Dag, which was the rebranding of the horses, was done under Alauddin Khilji. The idea was, this is an act to stop the substitution of thoroughbred of horses, and this would help in identification of the actual breed, and therefore Dag and Chera became one of the major systems under Alauddin Khilji. Next was his well-known revenue system. The revenue system was very very important. Also, during that his time, gifts were given to the noble as land, but the property was taken by the government. Drinking in public was prohibited. Marriage parties were prohibited. He developed a very efficient spy system, and for that he paid taxes. The taxes were paid by the nobles regularly to him. Also, there was the period where the nobles within the court started to rebel. Some of the major reasons for the rebel of the nobles within the court was the social gatherings, the drinking, and the habit of accumulating wealth. As we said, his idea was to have a good revenue system. In order to have a good revenue system, strong army was maintained and revenue was refixed. So it was collected strictly, it was refixed to new limit, and the areas which were more fertile had to pay more. For example, Ganga Yamuna Doab was the area which had to pay half of its produce as the tax, and therefore a huge amount came in the pockets of the Khilji dynasty or the Alauddin Khilji, which was spent for maintaining good army and an efficient spy system. Grains and agriculture definitely developed during that time. As we said, with the help of the funds that were raised, huge army could be maintained. He also had a good control over the market system. No overpricing could be done. All the markets were supervised and the prices for all the essential goods and commodities were fixed. There was a strict check on each of the traders, and all the revenue that was collected was spent ultimately where? Was spent on the army again, and it was an indicative of the economic reforms that were done under Alauddin Khilji. Now, art and architecture also prospered during the time of Alauddin Khilji. Two of the major people were Amir Khusro and Amir Hassan during the time of Alauddin Khilji. He is known to have numerous developments. For example, Alai Darwaza near Qutub Minar, then Alai Minar, which was started by Alauddin Khilji, the town of Siri near Delhi, which was established by Alauddin Khilji, and the Great Royal Bath, which was Hoskos, which is also present in Delhi, the region of Hoskos as of now. So those were the developments that were witnessed under Alauddin Khilji. He had a progressive attitude for all the reforms, and he did not want it that religion and state affairs should by any chance interfere. Now, under his rule, Malik Kafur was the most ablest of the persons, and Malik Kafur's story is further interesting. So what happened was, Alauddin Khilji raided Gujarat, and when he raided Gujarat from the port of Cambay, he brought a slave, and he was Malik Kafur. Malik Kafur was bought for 1,000 dinars during that time, and therefore his name was Hazar Dinari. Now, Hazar Dinari or Malik Kafur turned out to be the most trusted general under the rule of Alauddin Khilji. Now, with Malik Kafur coming to power, there was a series of invasion that started in India. But even before that, when Alauddin Khilji raided Gujarat, it was under Ulugh Khan and Nasrat Khan, and whole of the state was plundered, and with him came Malik Kafur. Now, Malik Kafur, as he became one of the most trusted general, he started his journey from Delhi, moved to the region of Ranthambore, Chittor, Mandu, Dhar, and moving further south, occupying the regions of Deccan. So in Daulatabad, under which was under the Yadavas, Warangal, which was under the Kakatiyas, Hosallias, who occupied the region of Dwar Samudra, and Pandyas, who occupied the region of Madurai, were all the regions that were invaded under Malik Kafur. So this was the path that Malik Kafur followed. And when it comes to the region of Deccan, the Yadavas, Kakatiyas, Hosallias and Pandyas, he did not annex any of these regions, but he actually realized annual tribute from the regions of southern states. Coming on to the regions of north, the region of Gujarat was already under power, and it was raided in 1299. Later on, there were raids that were done in Ranthambore. In Ranthambore in 1301, Chittorgarh in 1304. Now, Chittorgarh's story is again interesting. During that time, under Chittorgarh, Rana Ratan Singh was the king of Chittor, and Rani Padmini, who was known for her beauty, was the queen. Now, Alauddin Khilji wanted Rani Padmini to be part of Alauddin Khilji's dynasty. So what he did was, he did a trick and captured Raja Ratan Singh. However, with the help of Jaimal and Fatta, Rani Padmini was able to get hold of Rana Ratan Singh again. However, Alauddin Khilji did not stop. He invaded Chittorgarh again. Rana Ratan Singh was defeated, but Rani Padmini actually committed Johar in order to protect herself, and that was an act that had been a historically important one. Later on, the regions of Mandu, Ujjain, Dhar, Chanderi were all occupied and slowly and gradually annexed by Alauddin Khilji under Malik Kafur. Also, we have seen that all the states of Rajasthan, the regions of Ranthambore, Chittor, did not submit to him. him. But later he conquered the region of Malwa, and once he was able to conquer the region of Malwa, he was believed to be the real master of North India. And Ujjain, Dhar, Chanderi, Mandu, as we said, were all occupied as part of his proposition. So those were the developments that we witnessed under Alauddin Khilji. Alauddin Khilji's impact have been very, very important and historic in the Khilji dynasty. Next to Khilji dynasty was the Tughlaq dynasty. So Ghiyasuddin Tughlaq was the founder of Tughlaq dynasty, originally named as Ghazi Malik. Now what happened was Alauddin Khilji's general, who was Malik Kafur, the most trusted general, rose to power after Alauddin Khilji. However, the slaves had a conspiracy, and as a result, Malik Kafur was no longer the part of the Khilji dynasty, and therefore Tughlaq dynasty rose to power under Ghazi Malik, or Ghiyasuddin Tughlaq as he was called. Now Ghazi Malik was one of the most benevolent and strong rulers of that time. He was known for his firmness in decisions, and it is believed that his own son John Khan, who was later known as Muhammad bin Tughlaq, planned a conspiracy against Ghiyasuddin or Ghazi Malik, and in this conspiracy, a pavilion fell on Ghiyasuddin, and as a result, Ghiyasuddin lost his life. After him, as it was planned by his son John Khan or Muhammad bin Tughlaq, Muhammad bin Tughlaq rose to power. Muhammad bin Tughlaq, who was the son of Ghiyasuddin Tughlaq, who planned a conspiracy and led to the death of his father Ghazi Malik, ultimately rose to power after him. And Muhammad bin Tughlaq was known for his knowledge. He was a great mathematician, a great philosopher. He was a very learned and an accomplished person, but whatever he did, he failed totally as a ruler. As a ruler, he was not able to bring the schemes properly. Even the schemes which were good were not implemented properly. So in both ways, he was not one of the successful leaders, we could say, who could keep the empire united. There were four important happenings that happened under his reign, and those were the taxation in the Doab area, the transfer of capital, token currency, and failures of expedition. We would understand how these policies were responsible for the decline of the Tughlaq dynasty. And despite being an accomplished and a well-read, well-learned person, he created defective policies. So the first policy was the taxation in Doab. He believed that he should increase the land tax, and therefore he would be able to maintain a good army. So he increased the land tax, but unfortunately during the same time there was a severe famine, and the farmers were unable to pay that huge amount of tax, and believed that Muhammad bin Tughlaq would do undue justice to them, so they started to run away. Now Muhammad bin Tughlaq got informed about it. When he got informed about it, his policies, his ideas were shattered, and he tried to adopt a different policy where he was very liberal on his finances. So he started to give lots of loans. He started to give seeds for agriculture. He even started and asked people to dig wells, the payment of which would be made by the kingdom. But this was too late. At this point of time, all the farming system was under a collapse. So the taxation in the region of the Ganga Yamuna Doab predominantly failed because of the policies of Muhammad bin Tughlaq. The next defective policy was transfer of capital. Now, what he believed was he has established a stronghold in the North India, so it's a good time to move to south. He transferred his capital from Delhi to Devagiri, which is Daulatabad, present Daulatabad in Maharashtra. Now, when he moved from Delhi to Daulatabad, which was a distance of 708 miles long, This long distance, when his nobles, his soldiers started to move, a lot of them lost their life in between. Also, once there was Daulatabad, that was the seat, Mongols realized that they had a good stake in the north and they started to invade the regions of north. At this point, Muhammad bin Tughlaq found that Daulatabad is too south and taking a control of North India from this point becomes very, very difficult. So he twisted his views and immediately he said that this is not a feasible solution. We cannot remain in Daulatabad. Let's move back to Delhi. So he marched his army again back to Delhi, and in the meanwhile, a lot of people again lost their lives moving back from Daulatabad to Delhi. So ultimately, this whole event of transfer of capital from Delhi to Daulatabad or Daulatabad back to Delhi was nothing but a devastation for his people, his army, and a lot of people lost their life. A lot of expense from the Tughlaq Empire was seen because of this act. The next unsuccessful policy was the idea of token currency. So what he said, that the state was under a heavy economic burden because of the two events. What two events? The taxation policies in Doab and again the transfer of capital. And therefore, along with that, the Muhammad bin Tughlaq was used to a very lavish lifestyle. All of these brought in a huge deficit. So what he thought was, it's a good idea to introduce another coin, another currency. And so rather than gold and silver, he introduced what? He introduced copper currency at the same valuation as the gold and silver. The further interesting story is, the minting was not under the monopoly of the state. So many people started to imitate the royal coins, and therefore lots of fake coins came into market. Now, knowing this, Muhammad bin Tughlaq was totally surprised and he thought of immediately removing this copper currency. So he said all the copper coins should go away and should be replaced by gold and silver coin. So he asked people to bring the copper coins and in return he would pay them. So this again further brought a devastation to his already downtrodden economic system, creating a further impoverishment for the state. The last and the most unsuccessful event was his ideas of expedition. Now, what he did was, in the beginning, he marched his army to the region of Kangra near Himachal Pradesh, and away from Kangra, he was trying to capture Tibet. He started to move his army towards the region of Tibet, but soon realized that this is a very extreme condition and our army cannot survive this extreme climate conditions. So a lot of army either had to lose their life, and also a lot of funds went into vain. His second expedition was towards the region of Khursan. Now, Khursan was a region in Central Asia. He planned a huge army with new developed artilleries and weapons to have a march towards Khursan, and even paid the soldiers 1 year of advance salary to march towards the region of Khursan. But at that time, he realized that his treasury has suffered huge losses and this mission cannot be completed. So again, this project was totally laid off. Both of these were some of the major failures, but this was not the end. His repeated failures made him highly unpopular among the local people. Numerous revolts broke out in different areas. So in the east, you had West Bengal, in the west, the regions of Gujarat, Sindh, in the south, Tamil Nadu, Warangal. So these were the areas where people and the kingdoms started to separate out. And by 14th century, it is believed that from the east, Bengal, and from the west, Sindh, were lost by him. All of the region south of Narmada was also lost by him. So he remained with a very small region, and even in the south, Bahamani and Vijayanagar came to power as an independent kingdom. So overall, we could say, despite being a learned scholar, a great mathematician, his practical policies were very, very weak. Now, some of the developments, if we see under the time of Tughlaq dynasty, have been important. So the next ruler was Firoz Shah Tughlaq. Firoz Shah Tughlaq was the cousin of Muhammad bin Tughlaq, and he succeeded Muhammad bin Tughlaq in 1351. Now, it is believed that Tughlaqs failed to have the support from the ulemas and the nobles. So, there was an idea by Firoz Shah Tughlaq to make people more happy. Now, Firoz Shah Tughlaq led a series of development. He built four important cities. Those are Firozabad under his own name, Firoz Shah, Jaunpur in Uttar Pradesh, Fatehabad and Hisar in Haryana. He improved on the irrigation system, dug canals, wells, and also palace cum fort was built at Firoz Shah Kotla. It is also believed that two Ashokan pillars were brought, and one of those have been erected at Firoz Shah Kotla. So Firoz Shah Kotla was developed again under the name of Firoz Shah Tughlaq. Also, it is believed that hereditary rights of the land were given to the nobles and the people in army. But again, Firoz Shah was not that competent ruler. The region of Deccan and Bengal became independent. Campaigns from the regions of Sindh, Gujarat started because there was lots of mismanagement under Firoz Shah Tughlaq. Firoz Shah Tughlaq is also known to have established numerous schools, colleges, madrasas. He also established sarais for the travelers. His one charity fund is important, which is known as Diwan-e-Khairat, and this department of charity led a lot of relief to the poor people and bringing in employment for the jobless people. Scholars who were there translated Sanskrit scriptures to Persian language. Trade was promoted, octroi duty was reduced, advanced loans were given to families who were suffering from famine during that time. But after Tughlaq, we could see that the further successors of Tughlaq dynasties were very, very weak, and therefore the invasion of Timur was witnessed after Tughlaq dynasty. Followed by the invasion, we had the Sayyid and the Lodi dynasty that came to power after Timur. Once the Tughlaq dynasty and the Tughlaq rulers became weak, Timur saw a good point to invade India. His sole idea was to loot India and bring the wealth back to Samarkand and beautify the palaces, forts, and the region of Samarkand. Timur's invasion was the idea that led to the end of the Tughlaq dynasty. With more than 92,000 horsemen, he invaded India. He was from the Barlas tribe, and his sole idea was to follow the lines of Genghis Khan, who has seen the rule at the time of Iltutmish. Now, Timur was also known as Timur the Lame, and in Persian known as Timur-e-Lang. Timur tried to invade the region. So what happened is, in August 1398, he started from the region of Kabul. In just 4 months, he came to Delhi. When he came to Delhi, Sultan Mahmud Shah was one of the last sultans of Tughlaq dynasty, and his wazir actually fled away from Delhi. He looted Delhi for a period of 15 days, and within a period of 15 days, three of the regions of Delhi, Siri, Old Delhi and Jahanpana, all of those three were left dissolute. There was a large scale looting massacre that happened in the region. On his way back, He still looted the regions of Meerut, Haridwar, Kangra, Jammu, and before leaving India, he appointed Kyrgyz Khan. Now, Kyrgyz Khan was later the one who established the Sayyid dynasty in India. Kyrgyz Khan was appointed the ruler of the governor of the regions of Multan, Lahore, and Dayalpur. During his time, child marriage in Hindu practices was encouraged because they had seen that if they started marrying their daughters and sisters at a early age, they would be rescued from being snatched away, and therefore this period saw a lots of changes in terms of cultural changes, social changes that were seen. And as we say, he was one who was trying to build his empire in Samarkand, or it was known as Transoxiana. Now, Transoxiana included the parts of Afghanistan, Persia, Syria, the regions of Kurdistan, Baghdad, Georgia, and the regions of Asia Minor. The small region here was the region which was occupied by Ottoman Empire, and the region in the yellow, as you can see, was the empire of Mamluk or the slave dynasty that was left. So whole of the region which was seen in the green here was the region that was occupied by Timur, and this was known as Transoxiana. Timur established this vast empire by the wealth that he looted from the regions of Delhi. So Timur's invasion had been very, very historically important. It brought about a real devastation to the Delhi Sultanate, which was so far established till the time of Tughlaq dynasty after the Khilji dynasty. And as we said, one of his generals, who was Kyrgyz Khan, was kept as the governor of Multan, Lahore, and Dialpur. And later on, he started with the Sayyid dynasty, which was one of the next dynasties of Delhi Sultanate. Now, Kyrgyz Khan, as we know, was the governor of Multan, Lahore, and Dialpur, and he established the Sayyid dynasty. He was one of the governors of Timur and was appointed as deputy initially in India. Later on, laid the foundations of Sayyid dynasty. Timur, whose only aim was to beautify Samarkand, looted and plundered India, brought about a huge destruction to the economic and the social conditions. Now, when Kyrgyz Khan invaded and campaigned, Daulat Khan was in Delhi. Later on, Mubarak Shah, Muhammad Shah, Alauddin Shah were there, who also resigned. But his dynasty could not extend beyond the regions of Punjab and Doab. Last ruler of the Sayyid dynasty was Alauddin Shah Sayyid. He was one of the very weak rulers and was overthrown by Bahlul Lodi of the Lodi dynasty. So after the slaves, the Khilji came to power, Tughlaqs came to power, followed by the Sayyid dynasty. And since Sayyid dynasty was very, very weak, the ruler, the last ruler, Alauddin Shah Sayyid, surrendered to Bahlul Lodi, from where we had the initiation for the Lodi dynasty. Bahlul Lodi was the governor of Punjab and Sindh during that time. So under Bahlul Lodi, Lodi dynasty was established. Now Bahlul Lodi was the governor of Punjab and Sindh, and Bahlul Lodi saw that the weak Sayyids were the right point at which the Sayyid dynasty could be overthrown, and being an Afghan ruler, he established the Lodi dynasty as the first founder of Lodi dynasty with Bahlul Lodi. Next to him, one of the most ablest ruler of the Lodi dynasty was Sikandar Lodi. Sikandar Lodi is known to establish Agra, and later on we have seen under the Mughal Empire, lots of development and infrastructure, architecture marvels were established in Agra. But this Agra was first established by the Sikandar Lodi from the Lodi dynasty of Delhi Sultanate. Now, Sikandar Lodi captured the areas of Bihar, Jaunpur, and the regions of Ganga Valley. He improved the agriculture, the taxation systems, the economy, and people were actually very, very happy with Sikandar Lodi. However, later to Sikandar Lodi, Ibrahim Lodi came to power. At the time Ibrahim Lodi came to power, he was unable from the Afghan rulers. Also, there was lot of conspiracies that were plotted against Ibrahim Lodi. And finally, Daulat Khan Lodi, who was the uncle of Ibrahim Lodi, invited Babur to invade India. And as a result, the first battle of Panipat in 1526 was held between Babur and Ibrahim Lodi. Babur came from founder of the Mughal Empire in India, and with the defeat of Ibrahim Lodi, the Lodi dynasty came to an end and Mughal dynasty or Mughal Empire was established. So the end of the Delhi Sultanate can be seen with the first battle of Panipat, which was seen between Ibrahim Lodi and Babur, the point where Mughal dynasty started to gain control in India. So in this section, we have understood the five dynasties of Delhi Sultanate: the Slave dynasty, followed by the Khilji dynasty, the most ablest ruler being Alauddin Khilji. Under the Slave dynasty, Iltutmish was considered as the real founder, followed by Tughlaq dynasty. Under this, we have seen Muhammad bin Tughlaq, who was known for his failure policies, followed by the invasion of Timur, Sayyid dynasty established by Kyrgyz Khan, and finally the Lodi dynasty, under which we have seen Sikandar Lodi as one of the most ablest rulers of the Lodi dynasty. This Lodi dynasty came to an end with the first battle of Panipat, which was fought between Babur and Ibrahim Lodi, and Babur was invited by none the other, the uncle of Ibrahim Lodi, Daulat Khan Lodi himself. Thank you very much.